Oh, good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. Am I audible?
Yes, you are
Okay,
audible, you are
that's
audible.
fine.
Yes,
I
so
just
thank you for joining us once again. I mean, this series is really we are very happy with it, with the series, and it is really rocking, I should say. And once again, guys, we are meeting in this Dot Talk webinar series, especially dedicated to the issues related to Israel. And we have our speaker with Israel and its wars rising through fire. Now, without wasting any more time, I request Jyotiranjanji to please kindly take a charge of this virtual stage and please begin with the lecture. Thank you so much.
Yeah, I must be visible to you all now. Am I?
No, you. I guess there is some internet issue over there.
Yeah, just give me a second. I'll change my network then.
Okay,
I'll just
okay.
move it to a faster network.
Sure, but if there is a network issue, you can just switch off your camera also. That would also do.
Is it better now?
Yeah, your voice is coming. It is better.
Okay.
And still, there is a problem with your network, I guess. So I would request you to please keep switching your cam off if you have any
Okay.
data issue, no? That is why that
Just give
is.
me a second.
Yeah.
Okay, my cam is off. Now it's on.
Now it's on. Now it's okay,
Okay.
clear. But again,
You
we
can
can
see me?
see you. But whenever you have a problem with the data, you can simply switch off your camera. That's it. Right,
Okay.
sir. So please go ahead. Take the
I'll
charge.
just
Thank you.
start the presentation now. Entire screen. Okay. Dr. Aniruddha, is everything visible to you? The presentation? It must be reading loading.
Yes, it's loading. We'll have to wait for say. Yeah, it has come now. Israel rising through fire. Yes, presentation is on.
Perfect. So very welcome and good afternoon to everyone. So like in our first and second lectures, we have covered Israel, its origin, its formation, and then we went through how Israel has been fighting a small low-intensity conflict with Palestine, and it's been taking some time for Israel to even, let's say, even today, the borders of Israel. There is a lot of deliberation in that. And many people could still suggest that what one agrees as the border of Israel may not be agreeable to someone else. So the reason for that is also, we had, as some of you might remember, we had in a previous presentation discussed the Montevideo protocols to accept, for a nation to be accepted as a state. And we had one of the lines was territory, defined territory. Now, for that reason, many might say Israel doesn't have a defined territory. Well, there is some truth to that, but it still satisfies those Montevideo terms because if you point a finger, you know where Israel is. The final borders might not have been settled, but that's the case with many other states as well. But we do know if you point the finger where Israel is. So we'll just do a recap of what we had done in the previous lectures. Dr. Aniruddha, everything is visible and I'm audible?
Yes, you're audible and everything is visible. Yes.
Perfect.
Thank you.
So yeah. So last class, we had also seen the wall that separates, and we had called it the security barrier, and we had shown how it's not uniform. In different places, it manifests itself in different ways. We had also discussed the 1948 War of Independence in detail. And in this lecture today, we'll be mainly covering the wars, the major wars. So the interstate wars, the wars that Israel is known for. And we'll also talk about the tussle with Iran and the nuclear issues that Israel faces. The contents are on your screen. So the aim and structure I have discussed now. So like I said, this is where Israel is. So those who are there in the previous class, they might remember, recollect that we were discussing the geography of Israel. And we had discussed this image, this map. So here is Golan in the north. Here is the Dead Sea. This is the mountain of Samaria. This is the mountain of Judea. This is the Sharon Plain. You can see my pointer, the cursor. This is the Sharon Plain. Near Haifa, number three, this is the Carmel Mountain. And this is Galilee. And to the north of Galilee, you might see the Jezreel, not Jezreel, this is the Upper Galilee, Lebanon area. And this is the Jezreel Valley. And there's a Kidron Valley that connects Jerusalem to the Dead Sea. So this is the basic Israel, the main Israel, what you may call the Israel proper. But if we look at it better, so on the map, here is the Golan Heights. Here's the West Bank, here's the Gaza Strip, the Sharon Plains, Negev Desert, Egypt, the Suez Canal, and this is the Mediterranean Sea. It's very important for us to understand this today, because today we'll be discussing the wars, and throughout the wars, we'll be making references to these geographical areas again and again. So I would like you all to just go through it once, take some time. This is the Jordan River. This is Syria here, Lebanon here, Jordan here, Egypt here. Dr. Aniruddha, is it clear to you at least?
Yes, it's clear.
Perfect.
Yes, this is
Samaria, this is Judea. These are the mountains of Judea, this is the desert of Judea. Perfect. Okay. So the first war of independence that we had discussed, we'll be going through it, we'll be having a short brief for those who are joining us for the first time. So this shows us the directions in which the armies of the major Arab armies moved in towards Israel, and Israel defended itself, and it fought that few months of wars, and it was little more than a month, and then it went ahead. And we had also discussed why Israel actually was able to win, because it had unified command, volunteers, and more importantly, Israel was able to procure weapons, not just from Czechoslovakia, but also from other countries illegally. Because UN had said that there's going to be a blanket ban of import of weapons, but Israel had developed smuggling networks during the World War and also for the Civil War that preceded the War of Independence. And so these networks were very crucial, and it enabled Israel. So we see these were the countries that moved in, but Israel was able to repel them. And the blue color that you see, that was Israel from 1948 to 67. And in 67, something happens. We'll be discussing it soon. So as we said that there were people volunteering, also there were people who brought in bomber planes from US. There was a person who was having a vegetable fruit business in Puerto Rico, and he had large planes for that B-17 bomber type, and he happily lent them to Israel for its cause. Many of the excess World War II weapons were converted for use in Israel, and many people who went to volunteer to fight for Israel were not even Jews. They just came in because they felt for the land, and US in fact had ordered its citizens to not go ahead and fight. Once in a while, there were also funny stories. For instance, there were some people who went and bought a lot of weapons and said that we are buying it for the museum. We want to open a museum in Israel. We want to show children about World War II. They brought all everything. Then they retrofitted everything with the engineering and the machines, and they fixed what was not working, and they were good to fight. Many people even had to get such a letter from Israel to show to US that, see, we didn't fight. Yeah, so this was the gentleman who brought in a lot of weaponry, and he goes on to found that main company called IAI, Israel Aerospace Industries. Similarly, there were other people also who brought in their things. This is the gentleman who brought in the B-17s, Charlie Winters. And yeah, so coming to right after 1948 formation of Israel, there is constant tussle with its neighbors. There are a lot of fidayeen attacks, terror attacks, there are infiltrations. And what we see is that the communities and societies near the border of Israel, they have tractors for farming, but those are armored tractors. Then there are those there are teachers. If you look at pictures from that time, there are teachers teaching in classes with a gun around the shoulder. There are grown-ups guiding the children to play dodgeball, and the grown-ups are having guns around them. So it looks pretty weird, and this goes on. But coming to 1956, we come up with a Suez issue, the famous Suez crisis. In this cartoon, as you can see, this is the leader of Egypt back then, Gamal Nasser. So in 1952, there's a coup in Egypt because they all blame King Farouk of Egypt, who was ruler, for the loss in 1948. They say that the king is not able to do it. So the free officers, they engage in a coup and then they take power. And by 1954, Nasser is able to take power. So I'll just move ahead of time right now. So what happens first, they say the king is not able to do his job. So we need to bring in the leftist socialists like Nasser who are ruling. And when Nasser also loses wars, later on we'll come to see that, we see that the noise on the street is, see, even the socialist nationalists, even they are not able to defeat Israel. So we need more of Islam. So coming to the Arab Spring, we see that the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, in fact, won the last proper democratic elections during Arab Spring. And they had elected a Muslim Brothers person by the name of Morsi, who became the president, but then again the military moved him out. So there is constant tussle that who will win against Israel. So each time you have taken part in an Arab country back then, at least, you had to prove yourself that you are going to defeat Israel. So Nasser also goes on his trip, and in 1956, all this thing is happening. They are sending small fedayeens, small groups of terrorists and militiamen, but a proper war does take place, but it is not instigated by the Egyptians. It is instigated by others, because Nasser wanted to build a massive dam called the Aswan High Dam in Egypt, and Americans and the Brits had promised him that they would give him the required funding and they would give him what is needed. But suddenly they say, no, it's not feasible. We are not going to fund it. So Nasser then threatens that I'm going to blockade the Suez Canal. I'm going to nationalize it. I'm going to take it from you. And then I'm going to use the proceeds from the canal, the transit fee, the toll fee, and then I'm going to use that money to build the dam. Because of this, what happens, Great Britain and France, the owners of the canal, get terrified, and they conspire with Israel, and Israel invades Egypt in 1956, and thus we see the war. This is the Aswan High Dam, and that was Nasser promising people that, see, we are going to get the dam and we are going to use the proceeds for building our own dam using the canal. So this is how the war goes about. Israel invades, and then France and England say that, okay, we are going to use this as an excuse to land there. And once they land there, what happens is that the Western world, Soviet Union, they are totally against and they are aghast, and they are all forced to withdraw. Back then, the chief of the Israeli military, IDF, was Moshe Dayan, the gentleman with the one eye. And he had mobilized the tanks for this movement. And these are the British troops who had landed on the ships. So it doesn't go well, but Israel is able to demonstrate that it can take over entire Suez. And there's a newfound respect for this new country that it has power and it can demonstrate that power. And Dr. Enredda, everything going well? Hello?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So yeah, every 10 minutes.
Yes, can you hear me?
You just speak out so that I know that there's no internet disruption. Thank you. Perfect. So coming 1956, what this war demonstrates is that Israel has power. But following that, Israel is forced to withdraw back to its borders, and everything becomes like as it was before. But by 1965-66, it's Nasser who is making noise now. And there is clear-cut information that Egypt might invade Israel. Why we think so? Because first of all, there are some incidents that take place. Israel is forced to go ahead with raids in 1966 because they had been attacked. And also, what Nasser does is he blocks the Suez to Israelis, and he also blocks the Tehran, the Straits of Tehran. Now we'll have a look at the Straits of Tehran also. But before that, all these small tussles that were going on in 1966-67, there were battles with Syria, small battles that didn't make that much noise, but we all know that there was fire and there was smoke as well. So this is going on. And this is the small battle that takes place before the main six-day war of 1967. In January, we see that Syrians attack and the Israelis fight back, and Israelis take out many of the planes of Syria. And what happens finally is that in 67, the USSR delivers a warning to Syria and Cairo, Egypt, that see, Egypt and Syria, Israel is going to have an attack on you, Israel is going to attack you, and it is going to happen any day. But there is no clear proof, because Nasser sends his man to the border, and who checks it out that there is no real big military buildup from the Israeli side. But USSR insists that there is going to be an attack. And because these countries are kind of dependent on USSR for their military weapons and everything, they have to play along a bit. And during this time, Nasser was also engaged in the Yemeni civil war. Again, today we have a Yemeni civil war along those lines almost. Yeah. So Nasser, and they all keep on checking, and Nasser then goes ahead. He makes noise in the Arab street that I'm going to teach the Israelis a lesson for the 48. And he forces the UN troops who are guarding after 1956, the border between Egypt and Israel. He asks them to move. He blocks Suez and the Tehran Straits. So this is the map that you see, Mediterranean. Here is Egypt. This is the Sinai Peninsula. You see where my cursor is? This is Tehran. These are the Straits of Tehran. So if Egypt blocks it, Israel loses access to Asia. It can, because Suez is already blocked for them. So if they want, they have to go all around Africa and then go to China or India if they want to export or import anything. And back in that time, what happened is that none of the Arab countries were willing to sell oil to Israel. But there was one country who was willing to sell oil. Anyone wants to guess it? Any of the audiences? Who was the country who was willing to sell oil to Israel back then? Dr. Aniruddha?
Can't guess that, but okay, you go ahead. Tell us.
Yeah. So the country was Iran, because that time Iran was not the Islamic Republic of Iran. It was ruled by the Shah. And the Shah was an ally of Israel and the United States. So now they are having problem with even getting the oil for their everyday sustenance. So this creates a big headache. And Israel uses this as a casus belli, because they say that, see, they have blocked access, they have removed the UN troops. It means that they are going to attack. And Israel then sends Abba Eban and its other diplomats to US, ask them to send an aircraft carrier at least, ask Britain, please come in and say, maybe avoid a war. But all the Western countries tell Israel that, see, you are strong. Egypt is weak. Even if they attack you first, you will be able to teach them a lesson. So you please don't attack first, because if you attack first, then we won't be able to support you. Similarly, US also tells Egypt and Syria, do not attack first. Meanwhile, this is, as you can see, these are the zoom up of the states of Tehran. This is where the ships are supposed to pass. So Israel is in a dilemma. It knows that it's going to be attacked. What should it do? So Israel launches preemptively the Operation Focus on 5th June, early in the morning, 7:40. It is able to do so because it had very good intelligence. It knew the breakfast timing of the pilots. It knew what are the habits, at what time the Egyptian pilots fly, what are the Syrians doing, because they are also experienced fighting with Syrians. And they had some doubt about Jordan, because in 1948 war, if we remember, it was the Jordanians who had actually gained a lot of territory in the West Bank. And the Jordanian military was in fact taken seriously, because it was a British trained, British military. But the Jordanian also, they had been cooperating clandestinely sometimes with Israel on some issues. And Israel kind of tells Jordan, see Jordan, stay out of this conflict. You still have a lot of territory, you have Jerusalem, just stay out of it. But what happens is that Nasser invites the king of Jordan to his place. That time, I guess it was King Hussein. And he kind of convinces him to join the fight. And even the King Hussein doesn't have much leeway, because the streets in Jordan, even they all want to fight Israel. So Israel goes ahead with the attack on Egypt and Syria, a preemptive attack. As you can see, here is King Hussein standing with Nasser. And the gentleman on the top left, that's Levi Eshkol. He was the prime minister. Oh, no, it's not Levi Eshkol. He will come soon in our story. So the six-day war happens. Israel goes ahead in early morning, 7:40. They are able to take out much of Egypt's air force. They destroy it. In the first early hours, they take out 100 planes. And by the end of it, they have taken out 200 Egyptian planes. And Israel just keeps 12 of its planes for its home defense and deploys all of its air force. It goes in waves and waves. But the Israelis are very smart. They know that the Egyptians might be expecting an attack, even though the USA has told them to not be the first attacker. So they use this tactic. They fly the planes deep into Mediterranean and they attack from west to east or north to south, rather than the expected route of Israeli planes attacking from the east. So the planes go north, then they attack the bases in Egypt, and Sinai they attack from the west. So the Egyptians are kind of left wondering, and they have timed it very well. Right before this attack, a lot of the senior staff of the Egyptian Air Force and the army, they had just boarded an Aleutian plane to do an inspection of the troops in Sinai. Also, one of the leading generals, he had just told his staff members, "I'm going to sleep, please do not disturb me, no matter what happens." So when the attack happens, a lot of the important people who are supposed to lead the Egyptian military, they are in a plane. Another important person is sleeping. And the person who is actually there in the command center is left with nothing because all the planes are out. And this, you see, is an image of some of the Egyptian planes that have been destroyed while they were still on the airfield. And once that is done, the land is clear because Egyptian Air Force has been knocked out. So Israeli armor corps, Israeli tanks and infantry, they're able to leap through the Sinai in 3 days. So the six-day war of 1967 is actually a three-and-a-half-day war, because by the three-and-a-half-day, what happens is that Egypt is defeated. They have taken over Sinai, also Gaza Strip. And in the north, we see that here you see the prisoner of wars of Egypt. And in the north, they are also able to defeat Syria pretty easily, hands down. They take out the air force and they are able to cover much of the Golan Heights, and they take over the Golan Heights. When it comes to Jordan, Jordan is compelled to attack Israel because Egypt and Syria have been taken out, and it does a meek attack on Israel. But then Israel hits back hard and it takes over all of the West Bank and East Jerusalem. In the map, you see the dark blue arrows. Those are the movement that take place first. And then by the 7th of June, those light blue arrows, the one with the strikes, those are the movements of 7th of June. And the entire Jordanian army is compelled to move to the east of Jordan River. So Jordan kind of loses entire West Bank. And we might remember in 1948, there were a lot of Palestinian refugees. Now, again, the Palestinians of West Bank, they again become refugees. So often in the discourse, we'll hear refugees of 48, refugees of 67, because those who had taken refuge in the West Bank, and those people of West Bank who call themselves Palestinians, now again, they are forced to move out either out of West Bank, or they are internally displaced, or they continue to stay there, but without any representation in a parliament or in a state. Because when Jordan existed and it had taken over West Bank, it gave half of the seats in parliament to West Bank. But now Israel takes over the entire West Bank. And once it does, for the first time, the Israeli states and the Israeli people, they have access to the Temple Mount that we have often seen, and we also discussed in the previous lecture, the Temple Mount and the Western Wall. And here you see there's Moshe Dayan. Moshe Dayan, now what happens is that he makes most of the glory. In 1967, when the war started, the Prime Minister had made some meek voices, meek speeches, and the entire military leadership was aghast. They were like, "You have already lost us the war by showing our weakness to the enemy and making them not fear us." So what the Prime Minister does is he removes the defense portfolio from himself and he recalls the 1956 chief of IDF and makes him the defense minister, Moshe Dayan. And Moshe Dayan makes the maximum of it politically. When Israel takes over East Jerusalem and West Bank, Moshe Dayan goes everywhere and takes the first pictures, and they are available in the newspapers as soon as possible. Whereas the Prime Minister, he is not able to do it. So Levi Eshkol kind of loses his doubt, and Moshe Dayan builds his image as the tough man, the Sabra boy, the hero of 56, and again the savior in 67, who gets his back Jerusalem. And once that is done, on the right side map, if you see, Israel has now expanded itself by almost three times. And the Syrian front, the Golan Heights, is totally under it. Now, the Golan Heights is important because not only is it just a plateau, It is also the source of the Jordan River. And the Jordanians had been trying to divert the river for some time. And the river that and the catchment area in Golan Heights, in fact, feeds into the Sea of Galilee or the Lake Kinneret. And then the water there from there flows into the Jordan River. So back in the time, this was the main source for all the farmers in Galilee, the northern part of Israel. And if that could have been cut off, then Israel would have lost out on grain and food also. Already they have to import a lot of weapons. And this is what I had already discussed. Yeah. So the war ends with complete Israeli victory. But what happens is that Israel kind of loses something. By gaining territory, its total landmass or the population under Israeli control is not now entirely Jewish per se. Because now the number of Arabs within the same population increases by a large amount. They are almost 45% of the total population. But of course, many of them are restricted to West Bank and Gaza. But still, if you ask those people which country they belong to, they can't furnish a Palestinian passport that is workable. But Israel is kind of responsible for them now. Also, the Arab world passes its three nose in Khartoum, as we have discussed in last class. And the Fatah and all of them, they take on the mantle to fight for Israel now. Now, there's also the war of attrition that takes place. The war right after the Six-Day War, everybody is dismayed and everybody thinks that Israel cannot be defeated anymore because they are so powerful and they are so strong, we'll lose out. But Yasser Arafat still starts the PLO, and we have discussed the entire PLO's life in the previous webinar. And the stage is perhaps set for the next series of skirmishes in the form of war of attrition that goes on from 1968 to 1970, almost till the Battle of Karame. And after that, we see that these visuals that you see on the right, these are from the war of attrition from 67 to 70. These take place between the usual suspects, Israel versus Egypt, Israel versus Jordan, Israel versus Syria. But it is mainly done by the irregulars of PLO, and also once in a while between the bordermen, the border guards. Israel, meanwhile, builds a series of fortifications on the eastern side of the Suez Canal. They call it the Barlev Line, and they come with their own strategy. If you see on the right side map, this is the Suez Canal. On its right side, they build a series of fortifications. They have their own strategy to defend it with a few men. The plan is to build high sand embankments, and these sand embankments are supposed to prevent the Egyptian sides to mount a proper attack. Because first of all, to attack the Israeli side now, they have to cross the Suez Canal, the water body, and once they cross it, they have to face a high wall of sand. And the Israelis are very confident that now all the territory that they have is consolidated. And the dream, the Israeli dream, is to exchange territory for peace. So they offer the Israeli side, see, you recognize us, have peace with us, don't attack us, and we shall return Sinai to you. Similarly, they give offers to Syria and Jordan. We return you the West Bank. You have peace with us and you recognize us. Similarly with Syria. Now, Egypt kind of thinks back then that this is a very good deal. They should accept. But the people of Egypt cannot accept such a thing. So whoever leader takes such a step, he or she might well be assassinated or something along those lines. And it does happen later, as we shall see. The king of Jordan can't do it. Most of his people, or almost 30 to 40% are Palestinians. He can't be betraying them. And Syria is very adamant. Now, when the 67 war took place, the defense minister was Hafez al-Assad, the father of Bashar al-Assad. Bashar al-Assad is the current president of Syria. And he decides that he wants vengeance as well. He wants to take the fight back to the enemy. So he, back in the time, Syria used to have a coup once every 5-6 years, once every 3 years. So Bashar al-Assad's father, Hafez al-Assad, he also does this coup. And soon he's the president of Syria. Now, the war that we said, within 3.5 days, much of it had happened. On the fourth day, the Hebron had fallen to Israel. Fifth and sixth day, Israel devotes its time to Syria and takes off entire Golan. In the Arab world, this is known as the setback of 67. The 48th loss is referred to as the catastrophe, al-Nakba, and the 67 defeat is referred to as al-Naqsa, the setback. So we all know the situation was ripe for the next war because everybody wants their land back. And thus we have the Yom Kippur War. And this war is in fact a case of intelligence failure for Israel, because Israel had all the information with itself that a war is going to happen. In fact, the person who used to give massage to Nasser, his masseur, he was an Israeli agent. There were people who used to do gardening in the headquarter area of the Egyptian military. Even one or two of them were Israeli agents. In fact, even the son-in-law of Nasser, Marwan, Ashraf Marwan, whom we had mentioned in the previous lecture, even he was an Israeli agent. But it is often claimed that he was a double agent. To what extent, we shall see today a little bit. So the war of Yom Kippur starts. In the Arab world, it is known as the Ramadan War, because that year, Ramadan, as it is going on today, this year it is in April, back and in May. Back then it took place in October. And because in Hijri calendar, it is a lunar calendar, it doesn't exactly match itself to the Gregorian calendar. And but towards the end of the Yom Kippur War, Israelis do, they are able to stand back. What happens? So the Egyptians draw out a plan with Syria. They come and tell Syria, see Syria, you are going to attack from the north, we will attack from the south. And if you look at the borders, we see that Syria, if a Syrian is to attack Israel, he or she has to attack from east to west on the Golan Plateau, and Egypt has to attack from west to east. So what the Egyptians want is they want to attack in the evening time when the sun is behind them. So they propose that we should attack around 4 p.m., 5, 6 p.m., something like that. But the Syrian side want to attack in the morning time. Finally, the compromise time that they agree upon to attack Israel is afternoon, mid time. So this is a very bad decision making here, because it benefits no one, neither the Syrian side nor the Egyptian side, if we take into consideration the effect of sunlight. But that also plays an important role, and it kind of plays into their plan, overall plan. But the Egyptians are wily here. The Egyptians tell Syrians, we are going to take up all of Sinai Peninsula, the Sinai. But what they actually have, a second plan, secret plan, that they don't show the Syrians. The Egyptian plan is to move only a few kilometers, something like 10 to 15 kilometers into Sinai across the Suez Canal, and then compel the Egyptians to come and have a talk on the table and use diplomatic parleys to finally ensure that Egypt is able to get back entire Sinai Peninsula and make money off the Suez Canal. But the Syrians don't know this. So when the Egyptians attack, they attack pretty well. They attack very well. They are winning in many ways. And we shall see how they go about. But first, let's look at the intelligence failure. What happened? How come Israelis didn't come to know that they are going to have a war? They knew, but they didn't act upon. What happened? So Mossad chief was Zvi Zamir. This is an image from 2005 of Zvi Zamir. And he was the Mossad chief. Based on all intelligence he had, he knew that the Arab armies are going to attack. And he recommends that we should prepare, we should call up our reserves, and we should be ready to fight. But what happens is that the Amman chief, whose image will crop up on the right side, Eli Zaira, he says, no, there is no chance of an attack. Again, these two images of the two intelligence czars are from 2003 to 2013, that period. So they are pretty old. Right now, one of them is 93, one of them is 96 years old. They're still alive, and that's the case. And what happens? Zvi Zamir has access to the spy on the bottom left. This is Ashraf Marwan. This is also his one of his post 2000 picture images. But back then, when all this was happening in 73, and he was married to Nasser's daughter. This is Nasser's daughter. This is Nasser. So Ashraf Marwan was an Israeli spy. What happens? Ashraf Marwan is a young man who wants to live a dashing life. He also has a sense and love for adventure. And he knocks on the doors of the Israeli embassy in London. Not literally, he calls them on phone. He arrives by flight in London, calls them and tells them, hello, this is Ashraf Marwan, and I want to talk to your station chief for intelligence. And he tries to put forth himself. The Israeli says, okay, thank you, and they disconnect the phone. Sometimes more in earlier calls, they don't even respond to him, they disconnect the phone. Finally, the voice of this this information reaches the Mossad station chief in London. And he says, what? And he's totally shocked because you don't get such amazing assets walking to you straight away. So Ashraf Marwan wants money in exchange, but also Ashraf Marwan has some ideological reasons, because he has access to Soviet Union, because Soviet Union is an Egyptian ally, and he sees the system and he doesn't like the communist system. He doesn't like the Soviet way of doing things, and he kind of makes it heard that I don't want this for my country at least. And Ashraf Marwan becomes an Israeli spy. And coming to the 73 war, repeatedly Ashraf Marwan sends information that a war is coming, a war is coming. When? Not sure, unclear. Because of this, what happens is that many in the Israeli intelligence community, they are also having doubt about his loyalty. Is he giving us the right information or the wrong information? Because before the actual war happens, two, three times, entire Israeli military is brought onto the battlefield on the borderlines to be ready to attack or to ready to receive an attack and then fight back. But nothing happens. So there is the belief that maybe the attacks are all fake news and this is just propaganda to fool us, to ensure that we pull up all our reserves. Because Israeli army is mainly a reserve army. Most of the people who go to fight on the day of battle, they are engineers, doctors, teachers, who leave their job and who put on their fatigues and go to the battle. And there is a small component of 200 to 300,000, which is the professional army, but back then it was even smaller. And the small number of professional army is supposed to be backed by a larger reserve. But what happens here is that each time you call the reserve, Israeli economy suffers. And Eli Zaira, the military chief, clearly knows this. And Eli Zaira, because he's so adamant and confirmed that no attack is going to happen, he kind of delays the early warning systems. Now, Zvi Zamir, on the exact day of war, one day before it, Ashraf Marwan calls and he tells the code name, chemicals, which means attack is imminent. So Zvi Zamir flies to London where he meets Ashraf Marwan. And Ashraf Marwan says the attack is going to happen at 4 p.m., 6 p.m. So the next day, morning, 8 o'clock, the security cabinet of Israel meets and they are all ready to go fight a war. But the date is 6th of October. The date and the timing, they all think the attack is going to come is in the afternoon. So everybody mans up, things are moving. But the target time for them is 6 p.m. around. But Egyptians and Syrians attack at 2 p.m. as they had agreed as per their plan. Now this attack that takes at 2 p.m. shakes up Israel. And at that time, Moshe Dayan says that we might lose the third temple. That is, Israel as a state might be destroyed. But it doesn't happen per se, because Egypt doesn't move more than 12 kilometers. Syria, while it is trying to take up entire Golan Heights, what happens is that, let me show the image. Yeah. So the Egyptians, they come here, they destroy the Baalef fortresses. They come in, but they don't move forward because they know that their surface-to-air missiles, anti-aircraft missiles, have a range of only 12 to 15 kilometers. So beyond that, their aircrafts may not be able to back up their army. So they don't move forward. And the Syrians, while they attack, they stop after some time. They think that, okay, we have done enough progress today. And Hafez al-Assad says that we don't move forward. Now we regroup in the night. And while they are regrouping, what happens is that entire Israeli reserve force arrives at the border. This was the Egyptian attack, how they crossed the Suez. And one of the reasons for Egypt's success, at least in the 15-kilometer line, is that they use anti-tank missiles, these small ones called Sagars that they have got from Soviet Union here in the right side. And it takes out Israeli tanks like anything. And also they have any Israeli plane that flies into this area falls down because the Soviets have supplied Egyptians with these anti-aircraft missiles. The Syrians here, they were supposed to go to Nafek, but they failed to capture that. And the next day, what happens that Israelis arrive and they're able to push them back thence forward. This, you see, are the surprised Israeli troops of the first days, but later on they go ahead. Now we see they are winning. But what happens, because Nasser doesn't move forward beyond this, sorry, Nasser is dead by now, Sadat is the ruler in 73. So Sadat doesn't move and Syrians are constantly hemorrhaging at the Egyptians that please move ahead and relieve some pressure on us. But how can they relieve the pressure? Because even if they move ahead here, First of all, the troops of Israel here are going to be engaged, not the troops in the north. And secondly, even if they were to move, they would be beaten back. So Shazly, the Egyptian general, had come up with this plan that we will not move ahead with it. But then he's overruled and the Egyptian army is forced to go on the right side and they all move ahead. Like then Ariel Sharon here, his forces are here, and he makes this decision to send in scouts. And the scouts find this area. Dr. Anuruddha, can you see the arrow?
Yes.
Yeah. So this part near the Bitter Lakes is poorly guarded. They use this to transfer all the Israeli troops to the western side of Suez Canal. And Anwar Sadat and the other Egyptian generals are very adamant and traditional, and they say that not a step back. Shazly says that we should move back to the west of Suez Canal so that we can face off the Israelis. But they are forced to stay on the eastern bank of Suez. They don't move more than 12 kilometers because then Israeli planes might hit them. And they don't even move back. So what happens? Israelis cross this canal. They hit them from the back. And the Egyptian army is defeated in this way. And they are defeated. And one of the other reasons they are defeated is because many of these forces here, they also try to breach the 12 kilometer line because Soviet Union pressurizes them that you should move ahead so that pressure can be relieved. And whoever moves ahead, they are defeated by the Israeli side. And that's why Egypt is defeated. Syria is defeated because of its mistakes, because it doesn't move when the line, when the area in front of it is open. It wastes time, valuable time, and the Israelis arrive by then. In 2-3 days, Israelis are there, they are battling it out. And by this time, even the Israelis move ahead further towards Damascus. They are only after a ceasefire, two things come back to normal. And once again, while Israel had come pretty close to defeat, Israel comes out safe. Israel is saved. But the public and the commentators, they are very angry because how could a surprise attack be mounted on Israel? As we are talking over here, Zvi Zamir, the Mossad chief, and Eli Zaira, the Amman chief. Now, back then, they looked something like this. Younger, much younger. And Zvi Zamir kind of gave a false impression to his superiors, because each time the political leadership asked him, please check, is there going to be attack tomorrow or day after, something like that. He says, there is not going to be any attack. And back then, Israel had a special means, special tools, some electronic tools, these were. They were hidden in the sands outside of Cairo. In my best estimate, they were more than this hand's length and more than this width, and they were hidden in the sand. And these could be used to listen to the phone conversations of Egyptian army, Egyptian people, and they could even intercept some of the telegraph and fax information. So these systems were supposed to be switched on. So each time the political leadership asked the military intelligence chief, Zaira, to check, he said, there is no chance of war. And he almost gives them that impression that he's checking it, but he doesn't check it. Why he doesn't check it? Because a few days ago, they had activated this special means system, and one of these instruments had been captured by the Egyptians. So he's also scared. He doesn't want any further of these instruments from getting captured, and he doesn't even use them. So this is like a total waste. You have a system that is supposed to give you early warning, but you don't use it for the fear of that it might get captured. So he's kind of seen as the culprit because he doesn't use it. And when the information comes from the Mossad chief, Zamir, that the war is coming, he doesn't accept it. But by the time he accepts it, it is like 12 hours to the war. So nothing much can be done with his acceptance. Why does it happen? Because in the Israeli military intelligence, we noticed that there was this conception, the belief that Egypt will not attack us. Why will Egypt not attack us? Because its air force we had destroyed in 67, it hasn't built an air force that is as good as that air force. So it won't attack. And because Egypt won't attack, Syria will not have the guts to attack us alone. Hence, Egypt and Syria will not attack us. This belief is known as the Haq Conceptia, or the concept of the conception. And this was kind of, even when he was interviewed, the Amman chief, by the later Agranat Commission, which was set up to investigate why the surprise attack could be pulled off, he kind of says that it is not in my nature to push unnecessary information to my bosses. And I didn't think that an attack was going to come, because based on the information that I had, my assessment was that the war is not going to come. Maybe a problem, according to me, was, this is Zaira speaking, according to me, the problem was that we could not make sense of the information. And the problem was that we didn't, wasn't that we didn't have enough information. While Mossad was saying is that we should look for the information that says that a war is coming. So this gentleman that you see, this is Uri Bar Joseph, he has written some of the important books about the people, how the watchman fell asleep, the security guard, in this case, Ahmad, and that's why the war could happen. And this is Ashraf Marwan, who was known as the angel for the Israeli Mossad. And he also has done research, Uri Bar Joseph, on why Zaira has this way of thinking. So he takes inspiration from the psychological theories of this gentleman here. He's Kuglansky. He's a psychologist who had come up with the theory of cognitive closure or need for closure, which says that some people have this way of thinking that they want everything to be perfect the way they want it, and they are not very receptive to information that contradicts their framework or the structure of information that they have. The war, while the 67 war ended with total victory, the 73 war was seen as a result of Israel's hubris, overconfidence, that we will win no matter what. Arabs are weak, they can't fight. So here we have this example, a famous example, in fact. Some of you might recollect this man with the feathers from the Greek mythology, Achilles. And this was 67 war, but coming to 73 war, it was seen as the fall of Icarus. And now the belief is anything can happen. 73 wars confirms the belief that anything can happen if we are not careful. Now, after 73 war, we kind of come to the phase where Israel has to now fight other wars also. Now, in 78, Israel had moved into Lebanon, deep inside, because there was an important incident where Dalal Mughrabi had done the bus road accident. It is known in Israel as the bus massacre of Haifa. So what happens is that there are these bunch of PLO people who get onto a boat in Lebanon. If you remember, in 1970, Lebanon had to accept PLO, which had been kicked out of Jordan. So the PLO from Lebanon is now acting, and they go ahead with this coastal road massacre in Haifa. Because of this, Israel then decides that we'll push the PLO operatives from the southern part of Lebanon and northern part of to the north of Israel, will remove them from this part and push them further north. To do this, they engage in the Operation Father of Wisdom, which is soon renamed to Operation Litani. And in Operation Litani, Israel moves into Lebanon. They push back the PLO. They also push back other troops. But once they achieve their objectives, within 7 or 8 days, they come back to Israel. But what is happening in Lebanon right now? Since 1975, there's a civil war going on in Lebanon, and the PLO is one of the actors in this civil war. One of the reasons PLO is also very strong is because it has support from the leftist and the socialist militias, such as those of Walid Jumblat in Lebanon, and the Syrian government also supports the PLO. And in 1975, the Syrian military had moved into Lebanon to act as an arbitrator to keep the peace. So they are trying to play a matchmaker. They are trying to avoid too much warfare between the different parties. At the same time, their main aim is to secure their own interests. If someone is interested in this part, then there is a famous ambassador of Syria to Lebanon back then. He's seen as almost the person who's controlling the various strings of Lebanon during this time. This we'll come back to it later. So in 1978, Israel goes back, but by 1982, Israel comes back to fight in Lebanon once again. What happens is that there is constant aggression from the PLO operatives from the south of Lebanon. And on 3rd June, the Israeli ambassador in London is shot. He doesn't die, but he's shot. Israel uses this as the reason to move into Lebanon. And Israel supports the Lebanese forces, which are under the Christian Maronites there. And the leader is Pierre Jamal. And his son Bashir Jamal is, in fact, the person who is involved in the military matters. And they accept Israeli help and support 1981, Israel moves in. And the first thing they want is to move PLO out of Lebanon so that PLO doesn't have a home in Lebanon. But in this act that Israel is moving in with its large number of tanks, Israel moves in with almost 78,000 forces. That's a large number in Middle East. And Israel is no longer seen as the small David being besieged on all sides by powerful armies. Now Israel is being seen as a Goliath that is moving into Lebanon. This happens on 6 June and PLO is soon forced to leave Beirut and they move to Tunisia. Because what IDF does is, IDF surrounds their headquarters in Beirut and then they bomb it. And the only way out for Yasser Arafat is to accept to leave Lebanon and move to Tunisia. Israelis believe that this will give them breathing power and they don't have to worry so much about constant attacks from the north along in Haifa or in Kiryat Arba in that region. But soon after Yasser Arafat leaves and much of PLO leaves with him, Bashir Jamal, the person you see, Bashir, I mentioned here, Bashir Jamal is assassinated by one of the individuals who was affiliated with the Palestinians. In anger, the Lebanese forces, which are the forces of the Maronites under the leadership of Pierre and Bashir Jamal, but let us not assume that all Maronites also support them. Many don't support. Many other Christian groups are fighting for other sides because there are multiple sides and militias tend to change sides also, depending on availability of weapons or food and money or depending on safety. So the Lebanese forces go ahead and they commit a large-scale massacre in Shabra Shatila, in Lebanon, in South Lebanon, not South Lebanon, it is in Beirut, in the city of Beirut. And in fact, there is a movie called West Beirut. It shows us how the city is divided between poor, rich. So the poor are usually the Shia Muslim poor and the rich tend to be Sunni Muslim and the Christian Maronites who constitute the elite. And the poor are more or less restricted to West Beirut. And to the south of it are all these refugee camps of Palestinians. So that's where the Lebanese forces go in and they commit this massacre. But Israel holds some degree of blame to it. And there is also furor in the Israeli parliament. Because when this massacre is going on, the Israeli army, the IDF, is around this entire refugee camp. And after the PLO was kicked out of Lebanon, the promise that it was given is that the Palestinians will be kept safe. And many of the PLO IDF soldiers had fired flares to see that what is going on in the Shabra Shatila refugee camp. And the Lebanese forces of the Jamals or the Bashirs, they had used this light to go and file in and kill people. Finally, the massacre comes to an end after one full night. But once Israel is there in Lebanon, it comes into confrontation with Syria also. Because Syria, as I had mentioned a few minutes ago, is also present in Lebanon. And they are trying to act as the middleman, the arbitrator. So it is expected that Israelis and the Syrians will come into contact. They will end up fighting, and that's what happens. They fight, and the Israelis are able to take out the surface-to-air missiles of the Syrians. And the Israeli F-16s dominate the battlefield. Finally, there's an agreement that the Syrians will restrict themselves to the Bekaa Valley and the north of Bekaa Valley. The western part will be more with the Lebanese militias. The region south of Beirut will be with the Israelis. And the region south to it will be with the UN. Let me say it once again, if it's not clear. Bekaa Valley is on the east of Lebanon. And that part, the northern part will be controlled by Syrians. Rest of Lebanon, if you look, the northern part is with some Lebanese militias supported by Syrians. And the southern part of it is entirely dominated by the IDF. But the border area of Lebanon with Israel, that is still with UN. This occupation or the presence of Israeli troops in Lebanon goes on for the next two decades. And during this, what happens? Israel loses whatever goodwill it had in South Lebanon. Because when the first time the Israelis move in, what we see is that the Shiites who are present in South Lebanon, they're disenfranchised, they kind of are happy with IDF presence. The reason being, when other militias used to control territory, they used to engage in creating these posts, toll booths, where if any vehicle is going through there, they'll stop him, collect tax and take that money. or sometimes they will even kill people if they have not been paid on time. But the IDF, which is a more professional army, it doesn't do all that. In fact, Israelis provide medical aid to villages. They also provide schools to create goodwill. So the Shias in the earlier days till 1984 at least are very much supportive of the Israeli action in Lebanon. But by 1985, Hezbollah is created. And by 1990, almost all Shiites believe that the Israelis should not stay anymore. By 2000, finally, Israelis leave Lebanon entirely. But the vacuum that is left in the southern part of Lebanon, where Israel had its stronghold, now that is taken over by Hezbollah, which is a Shiite militia. And because they are present there, and Israelis are withdrawn, they create their own garrisons with monetary support from Iran. And they are also very much anti-Israel, because throughout the 1987, 88, 90s, they were the ones who were fighting Israelis in the South Lebanon area. And once they get this territory, because Israel has left and the Lebanese army is very weak, they use it to fire rockets, missiles. And in 2006, they even kidnapped two Israeli soldiers. If you can see this image, this is from the footage that was initially released by Hezbollah in 2016-17, much later. But this even happened in 2006. What happens is that there is this patrol. There are two Hummers that are patrolling the border with between Israel and Lebanon. And the Hezbollah troops, they are waiting in the bushes that with, and they have installed some IEDs below the soil. They have prepared the small shoulder launch missiles to attack these patrol parties. And they attack them. In the first attack, what happens, three soldiers die. They kidnap two who are remaining. And following it, but how did they do it? What the Hezbollah has done at first is they attack north of Israel. They randomly fire rockets in different settlements. When Israel's focus is entirely on that, at that time, they attack this patrol party and they kidnap the two soldiers. Israel doesn't exactly understand in the first few hours what has happened. And they send in a tank, an armored personnel carrier and a helicopter. And the tank is destroyed. And all four crew members die. One soldier from the armored personnel carrier, he also dies. You see this image? This is from one of those rockets that were fired in the northern Israel. And this entire zone that you see, this comes under the envelope of Lebanese rockets. In response to this kidnapping and killing, Israel launches its own operation, Change of Direction, which leads to a 34-day war, known as the Second Lebanon War. During this conflict, Israel doesn't make a permanent presence, but it moves into Lebanon, tries to take control, tries to destroy as much of Hezbollah outposts and missile sites, and it has some success. But what happens is that Hezbollah, they are from that land, and they have much greater knowledge and information of the terrain, and they engage in the classic guerrilla warfare. And one day, there was even a small radio cast by their chief, Sheikh Hassan Nasrallah, and he says that the ships that you see outside, and he's pointing to the ships that are right outside the Beirut harbor, because during this war, what happens is that the Israeli Navy blockades the waters, the Israeli Air Force blockades the air, the Beirut airport, which is the Rafiq Hariri airport, is destroyed as well, and Lebanon is kind of clubbed in. Even though Israel is not surrounding it, Israel has it by its throat. So Hassan Nasrallah, in one of these radio broadcasts, says that just look outside into the Sea of Beirut. That ship will be burnt right now. It will be attacked. And it kind of shows them his power. So if any of you want to see that clip of Hassan Nasrallah speaking on radio and telling that that ship will be destroyed, and right after that, that ship is in fact bombed. The ship doesn't fall out of action. The ship stays alive, but it catches fire. Four servicemen die. So if some of you are interested, I'm going to post in the chat box. Just a second. Yeah, this is the chat box.
Yes, please do that.
Because if I present the video will have a lag. So if you click on it, you can see that video. It's a 1 minute long video. And yeah. This is a video. You can play it right now if you want. You can play it after a gap if you want. And it's very interesting because it shows that it's an example of classic theater. There's a ship outside. The year is 2006. The ship belongs to the strongest military in the region. And Hassan Nasrallah, hiding in a small basement, is saying on radio, we'll attack them in the seas and all. And the ship is hit. The missile that is used to hit the ship is a Chinese missile. It's a C-802 Silkworm missile. It's a subsonic anti-ship cruise missile. And now China had not sold this missile to Hezbollah. China had sold it to Iran. And Iran had transferred it to Hezbollah. Now you see where I'm taking you all. I'm slowly and slightly taking you towards the Israel-Iranian conflict, because during the 90s also, much of the ammunition and the arms that the Hezbollah was using were in fact from Iran. The money that Hezbollah uses even today to sustain itself comes from Iran. And the 2006 war ends, the second Lebanon war ends, Israel withdraws, and there's an exchange of prisoners, because when the Hezbollah had kidnapped the two soldiers, even then they said that we'll return those two. You free the prisoners of Hezbollah that are in Israeli prisons. Israel won't allow itself to be let hostage, but because of the damage in the war, finally there's a swapping of prisoners, and the two soldiers, I think they return back in coffins. And with that, the second Lebanon war comes to an end. But the conflict doesn't. Even today, Israel sees Lebanon as one of the important sources of problems and troubles, and sees Hezbollah as a strong military force. But after 1978 invasion of Lebanon, then the 1982 invasion of Lebanon by IDF, something else had happened as well. Yeah. So in 1981, Israel gets the information that Iraq is building a nuclear facility with French support. And Israel launches the Operation Opera or Operation Babylon, and they go ahead and they destroy that entire site of reactors. You can see the image on the right side that shows you the reactor and the nuclear plant, power plant. Now, Iraq's excuse was that we were building it for producing energy. But Israel's doctrine is very clear under the Menachem Begin doctrine that any other country that tries to get nuclear weapons or nuclear capabilities in our neighborhood, we are going to ensure that they don't get the nuclear weapon. So Israel sends its F-16s and F-15s. Yeah, those are F-16s and F-15s. The F-16s did the bombing. The F-15, the Eagles, they provided the air dominance and the air superiority, and they ensured that the air was clear out of away from any intercepting planes. So there were 8 planes. Now, if we compare to the Indian Air Force, we use the Sukhoi 30s in the same role as the F-15s. That is air dominance, and we use our MiG-21s mainly as interceptors and dogfighters. The reactor was Osirak, famous for that name. If we just, and this was the path taken by the Israeli planes. Dr. Anirudha, can you see the image on my screen showing Saddam Hussein on the right side?
Yes, it is clear, it is clear.
Yeah, so this is the path they take. The Israeli planes go from the right over Saudi Arabia, and they attack the nuclear reactor and they come back. So this also tells you something. Even back then, the Israelis were more confident to fly over Saudi Arabia than over Jordan. But even the Jordanians exactly knew when this happened, because Saddam Hussein wasn't exactly a very friendly person with his neighbors, and he was fighting a lot. And when Israel did this Osirak attack under Operation Babylon, a few days before, Iranians had also attacked the same reactor, because Iranians don't want the Iraqis to have a nuclear weapon. And even after the 1979 Iranian Islamic Revolution, we see that the Israelis and the Iranians are in fact cooperating to a great extent. Throughout the Iran-Iraq war of 1980s, we see that Israel even supplies a lot of weapons and ammunitions to Iran. This is the F-16. That was being refueled. This is the exact image that was taken before it flew over the Osirak plane, before it flew, took off from Israel for these attacks. And this we discussed. The 82 war was known as the Operation Peace of Galilee, the first Lebanon war. Yes, we have discussed all this. Today, if you look at the Israeli and the Lebanese border, we see that the South Lebanon, there is no Israeli presence at all. There is Hezbollah presence. If you see my mouse cursor here, on the right side, if you go on a bus trip anywhere this area, and you look across the border, you'll be able to see Hezbollah flags. Similarly, in the southern part, these points that you see, these are all Hezbollah lookouts. And this border is in fact controlled by the United Nations under the UNIFIL. And I mentioned that first the Israelis took out the nuclear reactors of Iraq in 1981. The Lebanon Hezbollah war, the first Lebanon war take place. Israel invades Lebanon from 82 to 2000, has a presence there. In 2006, the second Lebanon war takes place for 34 days. And in 2007, Israel gets the information that Syria is this time building a reactor. Now, the Iraqi reactor that Iraq had built was also a plutonium reactor. So they wanted to use the waste of the uranium-based reactor, take out the plutonium and create an implosion device and then use it as a nuclear weapon. Syria also was going to build a plutonium plant. So this image that you see in the center, the left side is the image of the nuclear power plant, of the nuclear plant being built in Syria. This image that you see on the left, it was bombed on 6 September 2007 and ended up like this. And this happened under the operation outside the box. And this reactor has a very interesting story to it. Now you might understand Syria is not that rich a country. Though it has enmity with Israel, why would it go for building a nuclear weapon? And they probably understood that Israel might attack, US might oppose. So the funding for this reactor, it is believed by several sources, came from Iran. And the technology and the engineers and the scientists were in fact North Koreans. North Koreans were present there and they were helping them build this. So the image on the right side, Dr. Anuruddha, can you see this with a dome?
Yes.
This is the North Korean reactor. So you see the shape, the same rectangular shape, but what they have done in the case of the Syrian reactor, they had covered it up. They have covered the dome entirely so that it doesn't become that obvious that it's a nuclear reactor. But there were several similarities, and there were also images that were taken out of the laptops of some of the Syrian senior scientists, and they had images with the North Korean ones, with the North Korean scientists, and thus North Korea was in fact helping them. So it is believed money went from Iran to North Koreans. North Koreans sent their engineers and scientists to Syria, and finally Israel came and bombed this reactor. Now, the final and the most important phase of the conflict is with the Iranians. But till now, if anyone has any question, please ask us. We'll go ahead with the Iran part for 5-10 minutes. Any questions?
If there are any questions that can be raised.
Please go ahead.
We will take questions at the end of the program. No problem.
Yeah. If you have a question, please ask. Okay. Otherwise, I'll just.
Okay.
What's the story with Iran? So from 1950s, Iran had diplomatic relations with Israel. There was a El Al flight from Tel Aviv to Tehran regularly. So after Turkey, Iran was the second Muslim nation that had full relations with Israelis. And there was even a Hebrew school in Tehran, where because a lot of engineers and scientists from Israel used to go and work in Iran to help them build a lot of things. Because Israel had access to certain technologies that Iran wanted. Also, the Israelis and the Iranians, before 1978, they were building long-range missiles, the ICBM type, not exactly ICBM that range, but of course, they were ballistic missiles. So there was cooperation, even in military technology, and Iran used to sell its oil to Israel because no one was going to sell it and do that. And there was good relationships, you could say. Israelis and Iranians could travel to each other's country very easily. There were no restrictions. But the conservative section of Iranian society, the religious part led by the Ayatollahs, they didn't like this. They were against it. But the Iranian Shah, he was very happy with it. He was glad with it. And many of the weapon systems that Iranians were using, in fact, often used Israeli software, or they had some Israeli hand or Israeli design to it. This is how it went. But come to 1979, we have the Islamic Revolution and things change. and the Israelis are asked to shut their embassy in Tehran and go away. And in fact, what the Iranians do is they hand over this embassy to PLO to rub some salt on the injury. So they hand it over to PLO, and the Iranian, new Iran that comes into existence, the Islamic Republic of Iran, they want to be seen as those guys who were able to do what the Arab regimes were not able to. None of the Arab countries were able to defeat Israel in war. But the Iranians are saying, we are revolutionaries, we are better, because every revolution's claim is that we are better than the previous generation. So the Shah of Iran, he was a monarch. He was seen as just another monarch, like those in Saudi Arabia or Kuwait or Emirates. So the Iranian noise was that we are better, and revolutions tend to be more universal. So they wanted the revolution to spread, and they wanted to prove that where the others had failed, we are going to succeed. So they make it pretty evident that one of the agendas is to retake all the lands of Israel and make it Palestine, to ensure that Jerusalem comes back to the hands of the Palestinian sovereignty. They make all this noise. But when the PLO people come on a visit, many of the senior leaders come over to Iran for a visit, you must understand that the PLO were not that religious folks. They were very secular, they were very socialist, and they were along the lines of, in the Cold War era, if you look at it from the Cold War eye, they were with the Soviet camp on that side. Even back then, Indian government was also very close to the PLO, and Indian government also supported them in several ways. And when the PLO guys come to Iran, the first thing in evening they ask is, where is alcohol? And the Iranian government doesn't exactly like it, because they are trying to create an Islamic state, and here the PLO guys are coming from Palestine and they are saying, where is alcohol? So the Iranians don't exactly like it. And at further into the night, the PLO guys come out of the hotel rooms and they say, can we get some DVD movies, CD movies? Not, there were no CDs, DVDs, there were tapes back then, but they wanted to watch movies. They said, can you give us movies or can we go to a theater? But the Islamic regime was like, these guys are crazy. They want to drink alcohol, they want to watch movies. What is going on? So Iran and PLO don't exactly go ahead with great footing, but Iran is able to support Hamas, Palestinian Islamic Jihad in Gaza Strip and even in West Bank. And Iran also supports Hezbollah. And this support, while in initial days might have been very covert, in later days, it becomes very overt and on the face. For instance, this is a 2020 image of a briefing by Ali Hajizadeh, who was the chief of the aerospace for the IRGC. Now, Iran has two militaries. One is the Professional Army Navy Air Force, which is known as the Artesh. And then there's the IRGC, Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps. In Farsi, it's known as Sepah Pasdaran and Inqilab Islami. And in short, it is known as SEPA. So the SEPA and the Artesh are like the two forces in Iran. The SEPA is like the revolutionary armed forces, which belongs to the regime. The Artesh, or the Professional Army Navy Air Force, belongs to the nation. It's like the Chinese PLA. The PLA belongs to the party and not exactly to the nation. And because the party has taken over the state of China, so the PLA serves as the de facto Chinese army. But in Iran, there are two militaries. And this gentleman, he's from the IRGC, the SEPA. And he was having a briefing in 2020. It was in response to the assassination of Qasem Soleimani, I guess. And you see all these flags behind it. This flag is of Hamas. Can you see the arrow that I'm running around? Dr. Nirudha, can you see the arrow?
Yes.
Yeah. And these are the other affiliates serving in different countries. So you will find the flag of Houthis who are fighting in Yemen. So IRGC is pretty now on the face that yes, we fund them and yes, we run them. And one thing
is all those terrorist organizations, right?
Yeah. From the Western point of view, these are all terrorist organizations. But how do I say it? Hezbollah is a political party in Lebanon as well. They fight the elections as well, and they have an armed group as well. So Hezbollah has two hands, you can say. One fights elections, one fights with bullets. And
like communist.
Yeah, you could say like that. Yeah, it's very much along those revolutionary lines. In fact, I had a Chinese friend who was studying with me, and he drew several parallels between Iran and China. He said that Iran, when I study it, I feel that it is so similar to my country, except that they are poor and they don't have personal freedoms. That's how my Chinese friend had once put forth Iran.
Yes, correct.
And when now they are, you see, something is common in all these flags. I've put some of the flags. There's an AK-47 in all of them.
Yes, gun. I think AK-47, yes.
Yeah, and you see the design template. So more than often, if you see the design template, it means that it is being funded by the IRGC. This is a militia within Iran itself, Basij. This is Hezbollah. This is Kataib Hezbollah that serves in Iraq. And this is Ansar Allah, that is Houthis in Yemen. So often, if you see the Houthis, one of the shorter images that they used to show is this part. Only show this part. But the full image that you see in the Iranian media, like this image, I've taken it from the Tehran Times. So they showed the flag of the Houthis like this.
And none of these organizations are secular organizations. They all are Islamic fundamentalists.
Yeah, they are Islamic Shia. They are mainly Shia organizations. But one thing we must understand, they are very much against ISIS, Al-Qaeda. They are totally against them. Because ISIS, Al-Qaeda, they are all Islamists, but they are Sunni Islamist organizations. And these are Shia revolutionary organizations. Like if you go and ask any of their spokesperson, are you Islamist? They will say, we are revolutionary. That's why they have that AK-47 in the hand. They are fighting for a revolution according to them. And below the lower line images that you see, this you see it was taken from Deir Ez-Zor.
No, but according to their ideological allegiance and interpretation, so the revolution, and according to their political allegiance, theological allegiance, and their interpretation of their revolution. So it could be an Islamic revolution, not the revolution that that secular people could understand.
Exactly.
So
exactly.
It could be an Islamic
Very correct.
Revolution.
Yeah. They want an Iranian Islamic revolution, something along those lines. And the reason they take up the term revolution is because if you look at the Islamic history, for much of it, the Shias have been downtrodden, and it has been the Sunnis who have been in power. That's why there's also the Muharram, we see that, the Matam, right? So it reflects their sorrow and sadness. So on the left side that you see, this is the flag of Liwa Fatimiyan or Liwa Zinubin. Because see, in the Syrian conflict, the Syrian civil war, there have been a lot of militias that have taken part. And this is the flag of the militia that takes money from IRGC, but the most of the people who are members of it, they are from Afghanistan.
And they're taking money from what? They're taking money from what? From what source they take money?
IRGC, Iran.
Okay.
You see the flag with two guns, two AK-47s. And the second image that I'm dragging right now, this is the militia from Pakistan, consisting of Shias of Pakistan. These are known as Liwa Zainuddin and Liwa Fatimuddin, which means Fatimid Brigade and Zainab's Brigade in English, because Fatimid dynasty and Zainab, these are all important figures in Shiite historiography. And towards the right side, if you see, here is a fighter in Iraq with the flag of their affiliate of the IRGC. This map shows all these various organizations fighting in all these countries. Is it all visible?
Yes, it is clear and visible.
So Hezbollah in the north is the headache for Israel. Also Hamas and Palestinian Islamic Jihad, they are headaches for Israel. But because Iran has all these other proxies in Syria, Iraq, Yemen, so what this has led to is that the Arab world, UAE, Saudi Arabia, they all have kind of decided that they'll bury the hatchet with Israel. Even Egypt has signed the official peace agreement long ago, but now it is even happening at a much greater level. Thus, we saw that Abraham Accords were signed recently, and today there is an UAE ambassador in Israel. You can even go to his Twitter page. I think day before yesterday, he had his food in an Indian restaurant in Herzliya, day before yesterday, the ambassador of UAE to Israel. And yeah, he had it for iftar because there's Ramadan going on. And even Saudi Arabia and all, they have all come together and it has become a different war. So the Arab-Israeli conflict that we are talking about all this time, it has kind of become history in a sense. because most of these Arab countries have decided to put their stock with Israel. But in Iraq, the majority of the population is Shia, and thus Iran has a strong influence there. The regime of Bashar al-Assad in Syria also depends on Iranian and Russian support, and Hezbollah is there in Lebanon. Thus, we see there is a continuity here, which is often referred to as the Shia axis or the Iranian axis. And this allows Iran to have access to from Persian Gulf and Arabian Sea all the way to Mediterranean. And now, an interesting thing. As I had promised to talk about some of the cyber operations of Israel, now Iran, in 1979, under Shah, as we had discussed how Israel and Iran were coming together and they were trying to build a missile that was capable of carrying a nuclear weapon. So Israelis knew that Iran had nuclear ambitions under Shah. But once the Ayatollahs, they come to power, they don't have that much interest in nuclear weapons in initial days. But they make a lot of noise that we want the nuclear weapon, we want the nuclear weapon. But for some reason, maybe theological, maybe practical or money reason, they don't exactly move in the direction of creating a nuclear weapon. But coming to late 90s, we see that the Iranians actually want the nuclear weapon, but they make noise in the opposite direction, that we don't have nuclear weapons, we don't want nuclear weapons. In 80s, they said, we want nuclear weapons, but in effect, they are not actually pursuing it. In 90s and 2000s, they are saying that we are not pursuing nuclear weapons, but they are actually pursuing it in some ways, based on intelligence reports. So what happens often, since 2000, it has been noted that whenever there is a secret nuclear installation of Iran that Israel or the Western countries are able to discover, and the IAEA comes and tells Iran, oh, you had this nuclear installation, why didn't you report it to IAEA? Because Iran is a signatory of NPT and is also a member of IAEA. And what Iran's excuse sometimes has been is, oh, the person who was, the director was on leave, or we had run out of the legal paper with the header of our organization to send the letter, or the fax machine was not working, something along those lines. Because some of the excuses has been the person, the in charge person, he was on leave and he was the one who was supposed to send the letter. So often it has been seen that Iran is building something. Later on, when it is discovered, then it is forced to come clean. So one of the allegations is that if you were doing it for peaceful purposes, then why were you hiding it? And also, the nuclear program in Syria and Iraq that were destroyed by Israel, they were based on plutonium. But the nuclear weapon cycle that is being planned in Iran, and much of it is underground, it is uranium-based. Because for plutonium, for the entire circuitry, circuitry in the sense the cycle, nuclear cycle, tends to be smaller, but it is often more exposed to the soil. In case of uranium, you can divide it, like you can have the heavy water plant in Natanz, you can have the construction plant for uranium, or the place to prepare the yellow cake in one place, you can have the centrifuges being in another place. You can do the separation and keep everything at some distance. So should Israelis or someone attack these installations, not everything is destroyed in one go or one bombing run. Coming by 2006, Israelis are very adamant that they want to attack the Iranian nuclear installations. And the US under George Bush, they want to prevent that because already they are entangled in Iraq and Afghanistan. And in some ways, Iran was also helping the Americans in Afghanistan and in Iraq in the early days. And even in 2015-16, in its fight against ISIS, you had US military bases side by side with the Iranian proxy bases, and they were together fighting against ISIS. Of course, the US Army cannot say that we are cooperating with Iran, and they are not officially cooperating. But in 2006, US kind of tried to dissuade Israel from going ahead with a full-fledged bombing run with planes and all, like it had done in Iraq and in Syria. Instead, they come up with an Operation Olympic Games, which is a cyber attack. Israel's Unit 8200 and US's NSA, they both come together and they create a Stuxnet program. And it is smuggled into the centrifuges, the computer that handle it. So what happens is that sometimes the centrifuges, because of this program, it moves very slowly. Sometimes it moves very fast, but the Iranians are able to see there is some discrepancy, but they don't understand what is happening. So the hackers, Israeli side and the American side, they send a patch of file to the same computer in the centrifuge computers, and they send a patch up so that it patches it up. Now the Iranian computers show that everything is fine, everything is normal, but actually the centrifuge is moving very, very fast. The Iranians don't know this because their computers show them that everything is normal. Suddenly they hear exploding voices because the centrifuges, when it moves so fast, the material, it is designed to move at a particular speed and frequency. When it crosses that, things start breaking apart. Finally, by 2009, Kaspersky and one more company, they are able to discover that this was in fact Stuxnet, and they are able to discover it, and they are able to make it public because one of the Iranian engineers or scientists, he plugged his pen drive to this computer and then a laptop. He plugged his laptop to the centrifuge system and he brought it back home. And then from a pen drive, it moved from his laptop to many other computers, and then it spread around the world. And thus we had the Stuxnet in 2009, where there was a big scare and computers were being affected. Now, we came across the Olympic Games attack. And after that, what happens is that even till date, Israel hasn't exactly acknowledged that they were behind it. So we can't tell things for sure. But it is well known that Unit 8200 and NSA cooperated, and they were able to ensure that Iran moves away towards from its target. And then there was the JCPOA in 2014, which Israeli side didn't exactly want to happen because they preferred to destroy the Iranian nuclear facilities. And today, the deliberations that are going ahead between the Joe Biden administration and Iran is to increase the time period that takes for Iran to become nuclear. Because before JCPOA in 2014-15, that period, Iran was in a stage where, based on some assessments, it could build a nuclear weapon in 8 months. But more people believe that it could do so in 1 year. Because Iran had this capability, and today the US administration wants Iran for that gap, the time gap, to become even longer, so that then they can go ahead with further negotiation. But because Iranians are not willing to exactly go ahead and agree to many of the things, again, there was a recent attack in one of the nuclear installations this month, in fact, and it was all over the news again, once again. So we come back and we see that what happened then is happening once again. That's all, I guess, and you're all open to ask questions.
Yes, yes, yes. Very, very interesting session as usual. I mean, we have been learning a lot since the first lecture. So thank you so much for sharing your knowledge and most importantly, the experience. First question from my side. Okay, it may be related to Hamas itself. See, now since the establishment of Israel in 1948, okay, it has fought almost 8 recognized wars, right? So, and 2 Palestinian intifadas, and then a series of armed conflicts, if you look at in the broader Arab-Israeli conflict, right? So that was one thing, right? And then on the other, we look at, the Palestine Liberation Organization, which was PLO, which was relatively secular, right? And which was an ideology-based organization and was trying to fight for the rights of the Palestinians. And now we come to Hamas, right? Then Hamas is in a direct opposition to, the PLO, and also leadership is also quite opposite, which is a militant organization, political organization, also currently, in power in Gaza Strip, what I learned that this organization, Hamas, is also being funded by Iran, right? I mean, this is what, you can verify it if I'm wrong. Yes. So how do you see this journey from PLO and then now to Hamas? Okay. I think this is this ideological transformation, or conveniently the people have changed their basis, right? When they realize that their socialist revolutionary ideology not working, then let us go and support the Islamic fundamentalism. Actually, I don't understand one thing, right? I mean, with the Israel and Palestine conflict, okay, the theological conflicts also we get to see, right? I mean, the theological from perspective, right? So somewhere I feel that those people, okay, you may call them revolutionary or whatever, or West call them terrorist, right?
Yes, yeah.
They are taking refuge to the Islamic, the principles or the Quranic principles. So, what is the stand of the common Palestinian? I really want to know, okay, how does common Palestinian look at this transition? When Yasser Arafat, a wise leader, okay, secular person, and from Yasser Arafat to this, you know, these people, okay, who are celebrating fundamentalism and, you know, in the name of revolution. So what would be your take on it?
Yeah, thank you so much. It was an amazing question. And
thank you.
Something that's also close to my heart because, how do I say it? Personally speaking, I'm a big fan of Arab culture, Arab food, Arab music. My favorite musicians happen to be, there's one singer from Lebanon.
Amr Daeb, my favorite as well.
That name came out of me, but not exactly.
Okay.
Maybe I didn't sleep last night properly, but just give me a second. I'll find out his name, I guess. It's very embarrassing, to be honest. Yeah, Ziad Bourje. He's a Lebanese singer. And I can tell you the culture and all that is very amazing. But now we come to this part, that political part. Like, how does it happen? What is this change? So if you go to the streets of West Bank, you'd see that there is today a strong support for the Tanzim faction within the PLO, within the Fatah. Like, within Fatah, there was Yasser Arafat, who was more like a leader. But the Israeli side, if you ask them, they would see him as a terrorist as well. Because many of the terror attacks that were happening were by the fringes of his organization itself. Even he was commanding many of them. So they see him as a terrorist no matter what. But the people of Palestine, if you ask them, they say they saw him as a leader. And one of his military commanders was this guy, just give me a second, the Tanzim. Now the Tanzim within the Fatah was created so that they can carry out military actions or militant actions, if I may. And they had a leader. I'm just not getting his leader's name right now. Just give me a second. He's right now in a security prison in Israel. He has a lot of support within the, in the Palestinian street right now. And he has also been caught sometimes, like he engages in a lot of these fasts in the prison, but he has been caught violating that. I'll just take you 1 second. I want to give you the name of this person because his name is important. Because should he ever come out of the prison, yeah, his name is Marwan Barghouti. Marwan Barghouti, he is in a prison in Israel. The streets in West Bank, even within Fatah, there is more support for him than to say Fatah. Today, Yasser Arafat is no longer alive. In his place, we have Mahmoud Abbas, who is the president of the PA. But in this, and Mahmoud Abbas is a diplomat, he's a bureaucrat, he's a person who knows how to deal with the Israelis. He knows what to say, how to get angry, and then go ahead and make a proper deal so that the Palestinian people benefit. But the people also see the Fatah and the PLO and the PA, the Palestinian Authority, as a very corrupt organization. So the Hamas, because of its past legacy as a charity organization and its image that it has built as fighting against the strong, fighting for the weak, so it has some currency on the street that they are not corrupt. But should they have be in a position where they have all the power, we shall judge them how much corrupt they are, how much not corrupt they are. But today in the West Bank within Fatah, those people in power, they don't exactly want to move all the way to Islamism of Muslim Brotherhood, which Hamas follows, but they are willing to go ahead with an extreme version of Fatah ideology, a more like violent socialism under Marwan Barghouti. But we must understand these people, all of them, they are first and foremost Palestinians. They are nationalists, socialists, Islamists, much later. For them, their first goal is to get Palestine. But today, most of them understand that sacrificing all entire life for a political cause may not always be worth it. So many people live normal lives. They have a house in US or Canada. They have a business in Argentina. And you'll find this prosperous diaspora. And many people in West Bank also, they don't take this war that seriously. But when something happens, like during the recent Ramadan, barricades were put up near the Damascus Gate in Old City. So that instigated a lot of people. So the same people who are going to be supporting Fatah, if there is a stimulus and there is a certain atmosphere in the petri dish, they will suddenly back out and they will lash out against the ruling dispensation of the Palestinian society itself. But if you want to know whether the society per se is very radicalized, not so much. While these people had voted for Hamas in the election held in 2006 that time, but in their personal lives, they are not so radicalized, at least not in the Palestinian society when you compare it with, say, Egyptian society per se, because there has been a secular dominance for a long time. But see, the leadership was secular. It didn't give a regular dose of secularism in the form of injections to the society. So you might see many things that are very contradictory. For instance, in Palestinian society, you'll see a lot of confident young ladies who are willing to go ahead and take leadership. At the same time, it doesn't mean that we should equate it to same as West. Palestinian society is nothing like that. But there is, there is a desire to have a developed state rather than going ahead with an Islamist state. But given that once in a while there is a conflict with Israel, at that time when they vote for the party or the militia that is most capable of fighting Israel, or even if it is not capable, if it claims, goes ahead with the bravado. For instance, Hamas is not that capable, it is not that rich. But what happens is that it says that we'll give up our everything. We'll throw all our rockets at Israel. The fact that it is able to make a political claim or take up a political stance that no other party in West Bank is able to take, that itself entices it to the Palestinian people at some level that we are able to hit back, we are able to fight back. I think I'm not answered the question entirely, but I've made an effort.
No, indeed. I mean, I really understood, especially about the society. Okay, so transition has happened, but society is relatively still free. Their conscience and their thoughts are also free. And basically what they are imagining is a free world, not an ideologically radicalized world.
Yeah, and I'd like to tell you one thing. The way we see freedom, right? Their freedom is seen as a different thing. Because
please explain.
Getting closer to Islam, for many people, even in Hamas ideology, getting closer to Islam is getting closer to democracy. For them, the Quran is the constitution. The Shura is the parliament. For them, having an Islamic rule is like, for them, it's the best form of democracy. On the other hand, a Western open liberal democracy, by Hamas standards, they see it as a decadent one. But I would also like to give you some extra information here. In West Bank, you will find a lot of shops of Victoria's Secrets. I don't think we can see that in India that much. In West Bank, if you go to Nablus or even in Ramallah, you'll be able to see KFC, you'll find Victoria's Secrets, you'll find all those amazing brands. At the same time, many of the brands are not even available. I'll admit that also. They have IPTV in their homes. Many of the people, a normal school teacher has internet protocol TV in their homes. India, we don't have it till now. In Palestine, those families, they have internet TV. I'm not talking about Netflix and all. Before Netflix and all this became common, there was an attempt to come up with internet IPTV, that it is just like cable, but over the internet. So they went ahead all that. And if you go and look at the roads and the streets of Palestine, they are way better than India. The roads are so slick, you'd be surprised. The suffering and all that we see on TV, it is mainly the refugee camps within West Bank, like Tel Balata or the other refugee camps that I'd shown the images in the previous one. So even the sociology within the refugee camp is different. And in the normal city like Ramallah, you'll find alcohol, you'll find the best bars, you'll have the best parties, you'll find the best DJs. But if you go to a refugee camp, all these things cannot be there because the people are relatively poor. And when people are poor, whatever they have, they tend to celebrate it more. So they have religion, and religion is not that expensive. So they celebrate it more. And even in Ramallah, homosexuality is more tolerated than to say in a city like Nablus. Yeah, and any other questions? I see there are a few people like Nikivi Shohe and Sulito Shohe. I'd be happy if you ask, have any questions. And Dr. Anirudha, you can ask further questions also. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes, Mr. Shohei, Ms. Shohei, Likhi Shohei, yeah, you are speaking. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir.
Yes, please go ahead.
Sir, okay, up until now, is there a possible whether Iraq and Israel will be
pardon me?
Sir, shall I die? Because there's a problem.
Just give me a second. I'll put my headphone. Oh, okay. Just a second. Yeah. Likivi, you were asking a question. Could you repeat? I would be able to hear it better now, I guess.
Okay, sir. Sir, since the beginning between Iraq and Israel, so is there any possible whether there'll be a peace among them? Is there a possible
among whom? Israel and
Israel, Iraq.
Iraq or Iran?
Yes. I said Iran, just Iran.
Oh, Israel and Iran, right? Am I getting you right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so it is very much possible because, how do I say, in politics, there is no hard and fast rule. And people in higher leadership, they usually tend to be very flexible. For instance, in 1948, if someone would have said that the Egyptians and the Israelis would make peace, it would have been difficult to even think of it. In 1970s, if someone would have said that the PLO and Israel would have made peace, people might have even laughed at them, because they were fighting constantly. And when it comes to Iran, the people, most of the people on the street, the people who live there, they don't have a particular reason to hate Israel per se. And in Israel also, people love Iran, people love Iranian culture, people love Iranian food. The anger is more against the Iranian government and the regime. Now, from what I understand and see, the Iranian regime is very strong in Iran, and it is not that there will be a revolution tomorrow and the government will fall. But yeah, the government might fall in 50 or 40 years if they mismanage the economy very badly and there's a revolution by the common people and they push it out. It's even possible in 10, 20 years. But that need not even happen. Even the Ayatollah-led regime, the Ayatollahs who rule Iran, there's a moderate faction and there's an extreme faction. And at the end of it, if the leadership on top, like today, the foreign minister, Javad Zarif, he's not exactly an extremist. Neither is the President Rouhani. They are more liberal. The clergy would like more hardline leaders to come to power. But these leaders, if they act very nice with Israel, the clergy will instigate the people and other devoted and devout people against the liberal parties. So once in a while, the president and the foreign minister, they are, though liberals, they have to make statements which might be echoing the voice of the conservatives. They have to do it for survival. For instance, in 10 years, France and United States tell Iran that we'll give you nuclear energy, but we will come and we'll operate the nuclear power plants in your country. And let's say Iran accepts it, and Iran gives up any of its domestic or indigenous nuclear power, and maybe it opens up more to the market forces. Then once Iran is opened up without sanctions, it will be in some or the other trade relationship with Israel. Because even in 2000 and 2005, there was business between Israel and Iran. How funny it might sound, but that's how it was. It was happening through proxies. There's an Israeli businessman. He maybe wants to sell the technology for water purification or desalination. So So he will sell, transfer it through Turkey and Norway, and then it will go to Iran. The sticker will be everything of a different company altogether. It won't have the, any Hebrew letters or any thing aiming towards Israel, so that once it is deployed in Iran, nobody knows it. At the same time, who are these people who have the capability to buy and import all these things from an Israeli businessman? They are, of course, the elite. The elite cannot survive in Iran without support from the clergy. So more than often, these are relatives of some or the other person who is related to the revolution. So while people seem to be fighting, they seem to be cooperating at some level as well. So depending on the situation and what they have, they will change their stances. But they can't do it suddenly, because even China in 1950s and 60s was against US. But in 1962, even Mao had said to the Americans, to Nixon, that see, we can't suddenly be singing praises for you. So we'll keep abusing you for some years, but don't take it to heart. It is just to keep our people happy.
Interesting. Nikivi, are you satisfied with the answer?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much for your question. Anyway, now it is really a time for us to conclude the session. Jyoti Ranjanji, thank you for coming. You have delivered 3 successful lectures and we got really enlightened. And these are the topics which normally are not actually discussed, you know, in the Indian academia, actually, I should say. But people like you, those who are so dedicated to understand and learn more about Israel and Palestine issue, are like hopes for us, right? And also the source of information. So in this context, I would like to request you to kindly come up with 1 or 2 more lectures.
Sure.
Okay, for our students.
And I would also like to apologize because these lectures are so dense and there is so much content, and even I must apologize. I think it should, I personally believe that every 5 slides is in fact good enough for 1 full lecture. But we have so many and we have to compress
what, it. What I understand, Jyotiji, what I understand is, you know, we cannot measure the knowledge, right?
Yes,
whatever is coming from your side, we are taking it. And we are really grateful for that. Thank you so much. Yeah. So I'm looking forward to yet another couple of lectures. Yes. Okay.
Sure.
So thank you so much. And have a great evening ahead. So
Nikki,
thank you for your question and all the participations. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Dr. Aniruddha, I would like to just make one point that I think that many of the topics we discussed, we didn't discuss them in depth. In fact, each of them can be discussed in depth. So I would like you to, maybe you can do a small survey in your classroom, maybe what topics the students want. I can come up with each of the topic. I can even do it on a monthly basis or maybe once in 2 weeks. So whichever topic they want, I will come up with the slides of that. And
I will email you. Yes, I will inform you.
Yeah. Maybe a small survey with the students, what topics they want.
Right. Right. Yes. Then. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Have a great evening. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.